Senator Rivera.
Mr. President, I wonder if the sponsor would yield for a few questions.
Senator DeFrancisco, do you yield?
Yes, I would.
Sponsor yields.
Thank you, Mr. President. I wanted to take some time to, first of all, I just for the record, I obviously would have preferred the what Senator Parker just laid out to be something that we approved, because obviously having, this is a very important institution, SUNY Downstate, and so I would have preferred that we resolved it in the way that Senator Parker just proposed in his amendment. But as we are speaking on this particular budget bill, I wanted to specifically ask a few questions, Mr. President, through you, of Part Q of this particular budget bill. I wanted to, first of all, through you, Mr. President, if the sponsor could just briefly kind of state what the purpose of this particular section is. Let's start there and then work our way through the sections.
The purpose of the section of the bill is to do our best to not only save Downstate, but also to make it a vibrant facility for the same people that Senator Parker mentioned. It was important to have this institution a viable institution. In the period of time in which there were budget negotiations, the determination by the negotiators was that we should get a report, a sustainability plan from SUNY, and that's got to be done by June 1st of this year, in just a couple months, and submit that plan to the executive and the legislature to come up, to provide us recommendations on how to save it. And it also calls for some funding to be made available by SUNY, and hopefully to be matched by the federal government through Medicaid, to provide some initial funding to get the viability, to get Downstate back operating. But that funding will not happen until we see what the report is, or until the report is finalized. So rather than rush to a result and just throw money at it, like Litch was thrown at it in the past, which caused more problems for Downstate than they had before Litch was merged into Downstate, a more prudent plan would be to make sure that it's done in a deliberate way. And that's what's happening. I don't think anybody in this legislature, no matter where we live, want to lose Downstate Hospital.
Through you, Mr. President, if the sponsor would continue to yield.
Yes.
Thank you, Mr. President. I agree with you. No one in the legislature, and I don't think anybody in the state of New York would want an institution like this that provides such basic services to an important part of our state for it to go away. But I actually want to dig a little bit deeper. Could you tell me, particularly on Section 2, there is a mention of a sustainability plan. You mentioned it yourself. Could you tell me what the definition of a sustainability plan is? What are the parameters for a sustainability plan?
Well, I don't think there's a definition in the bill, but sustainability and plan have plain meanings. The sustainability is to make sure it continues as a viable hospital, and a plan is how they propose that this is going to happen.
Through you, Mr. President, if the sponsor would continue to yield.
Francisco.
Yes.
Sponsor yields.
Thank you, Mr. President. So was it not, do you not believe it is necessary for us to lay out some specifics as far as what the parameters of a sustainability plan should be to make sure that everything that you've been saying about the institution and how important it is to maintain it, wouldn't it have been important to include language that was specific in that regard in the language itself of the bill?
Yes. As far as the more parameters that you lay in the bill, the less flexibility SUNY has to try to find a viable solution. And I don't think anybody in this legislature really wants to limit the SUNY from making a reasonable plan that they feel will work, since some of the money is going to come from the SUNY coffers, and since they have two other hospitals that are currently existing and they run hospitals in a specific way. I think the concept was to give them the most flexibility as we could.
Through you, Mr. President, if the sponsor would continue to yield.
Yes.
Thank you, Mr. President. There is, I understand the issue of flexibility, but again, would not have been wiser to at least set some parameters as far as perhaps services that should be maintained, as far as populations that should be served. If we're talking about the impact that the close of this institution or changes to this institution would have, would it not have been prudent to include language that was, I understand the issue about flexibility. We're not going to have a listing of 3 or 4 pages that outlined exactly what a sustainability plan should have, but at least some general parameters to make sure that the institution would continue to exist in a way that would continue to provide the services that are necessary for the population that it serves. Would that, through you, Mr. President, would that not have been prudent?
One school of thought, I just think the more flexibility, the better. In Section 3, there's also some language that says that such sustainability plan shall include the elimination and or reduction of acute, ambulatory, and supportive services that are not necessary or financially sustainable, and any additional measures necessary to achieve such restructuring and achieve financial stability. I think that's the primary word, financial stability. One plan just a couple years ago was to acquire Litch. Well, that didn't bring financial stability. The hospital downstate was hemorrhaging millions every month. So I guess the guidelines are we want it sustainable, we want it to be a viable part of our healthcare system, and secondly, we want to make sure that the plan comes up with something that's financially feasible so we don't have another problem 2-3 years down the road.
Through you, Mr. President, if the sponsor would continue to yield.
Yes.
Thank you, Mr. President. You earlier, through you, Mr. President, Senator DeFrancisco, earlier you referred to a report.
Pardon me?
You referred to, if I'm not mistaken, and we can go to a transcript, you referred to a report that this language would require to be produced at the end of this process, something of that nature. I don't recall finding a language that referred to a report.
I don't think it was a report. It's a plan, sustainability plan. I don't remember using the words. If I did, then I was mistaken.
You're referring to the plan.
The plan.
All right. Through you, Mr. President, if the sponsor would continue to yield.
Senator DeFrancisco, do you yield?
Yes, I do.
Sponsor continues to yield.
Thank you, Mr. President. I want to get to one part, which is, we're talking, well, I'm going to go by sections. Moving on to Section 5 for a second. You talked about, you referred to it earlier as far as the timeline is concerned. I want to talk about that timeline a little bit. If I'm not mistaken, the bill as written would require for a plan to be created by June 1st and then approved within 2 weeks by June 15th to be implemented, not approved, but implemented. If I'm not mistaken, that is the language that is included in the bill. I have a couple of questions about that. Let's start with this one through you, Mr. President. Do you feel that that is both enough time for a plan to be put together and, more importantly, for it to be implemented?
Well, I guess you're damned if you do and you're damned if you don't. On the one hand, you want something to be done now, so we put the negotiators put a short leash on it so the report be done by June 1. And that the plan would begin to be implemented 2 weeks later. So I guess that's the compromise. We can't do it right now, but we want to make sure that the situation doesn't get worse before something concrete is done.
Mr. President, through you, if the sponsor would continue to yield.
Yes.
I want to make sure that I understand the exact context of damned if you do, damned if you don't. I don't, which is why I'm going to ask for clarification. Do you mean to say that you would have written the language differently, or do you mean to say that the folks that are implementing or would be asked to implement?
If I could ask
Senator Libous,
both senators to direct everything through the chair, it would be a lot easier for us to follow. Thank you. I'm getting older, and it's harder for me to follow the debate.
Thank you, Senator Libous. Mr. President.
Senator Rivera.
Through you. On an answer to a prior question that Senator DeFrancisco made related to comment damned if you do, damned if you don't, just want to clarify that term since I did not understand it. Perhaps you did, Mr. President. Does it relate either to how he would have negotiated the language or we would put the language forth differently, or does he refer to the folks that would be implementing the plan? Would they be damned if they don't, damned if they do? I'm just repeating through you, Mr. President, what was answered earlier.
What I meant by that was, I thought it was clear, but what I meant by that was, on the one hand, you're saying you're unhappy that there's nothing for downstate to keep the thing open in this budget. And on the other hand, when we have a short leash to get a comprehensive financial and other plan by SUNY by June 1 and then implemented by June 15th, do we have enough time? So on the one hand, we're being criticized for not doing something now, and on the other hand, we are being criticized or questioned on such a short leash and a short time to begin implementation. You're either damned if you do, or you're damned if you don't.
Through you, Mr. President, if the sponsor would continue to yield.
Senator DeFrancisco?
Yes.
Sponsor yields.
Thank you, Mr. President. I would thank, through you, Senator DeFrancisco for that clarification. I will also, just for the record, state that I was making sure that I knew exactly what he meant, and that really what I'm trying to establish is whether it is believed that this is a prudent timeline, I'm going to take it to mean that Senator DeFrancisco believes that it is a prudent timeline. But I want to actually move down a couple of sections to Section 6, and this is one that, Mr. President, I want to make sure that we really explore, because this is the one that, to be honest with you, causes me one of the most concerning parts of this whole bill. Through you, Mr. President, could the sponsor describe, generally speaking, the purpose of this particular section of the bill?
I'm sorry, I missed the last part of the question. Referring to paragraph 6, what would you like to know about that?
Through you, Mr. President, I would, if Senator DeFrancisco, if the sponsor could tell us, first of all, the purpose of Section 6 of this bill.
Well, in the effort, once again, to move to a solution as quickly as possible, this section allows for the waiver of certain provisions of the law and allows downstate or the upstate to enter contracts without competitive bidding or request for proposals. In other words, we want to get a decision made quickly on the sustainability plan, and we want implementation to happen as quickly as possible. And if we had to then, after a plan was formed, then competitively bid, wait another 6 months, another 8 months while the hospital's hemorrhaging money, there's less chance of it becoming a viable organization again. That's the purpose of the language.
Through you, Mr. President, if the sponsor would continue to yield.
Yes.
Sponsor yields.
Thank you, Mr. President. Through you, if the sponsor, there's language in this legislation, particularly in this section, which refers to State Finance Law 112, to State Finance Law 163, and to Education Law 355. I was wondering if the sponsor could tell us what those particular sections of the law refer to.
They refer to, in each of those areas of the law, the requirement of competitive bidding, or RFPs. Depending upon the section, it has those requirements for contracting by the state. This would, as it relates to each one of those sections, whether it's competitive bidding or RFPs, would give the SUNY the opportunity to waive that competitive bidding process or RFP process.
Through you, Mr. President, the sponsor would continue to yield.
Yes.
Sponsor yields.
Through you, Mr. President, in all of these instances, what we're talking about, one of them, for the record, State Finance Law 212 requires any contract of $50,000 or more and $50,000 or more for all agencies except OGS and $85,000 and above for OGS to be reviewed and approved by the controller before it's effective. State Finance Law 163 establishes standards for state agencies to follow in regards for procurement, including operating principles for evaluating offers and awarding contracts, and Education Law 355 authorizes the board, as it refers to the SUNY Board of Trustees, authorizes the board to execute contracts and include requirements to purchase the lowest purchase price under the competitive process. In all of these instances, through you, Mr. President, what this section does is exclude, I want to make sure that I clarify, that I'm clear with this, it excludes the institution of SUNY Downstate from any and all of these pieces of the law. Is that correct through you, Mr. President?
I don't have the finance law in hand or the education law, but the economic development law, section 142, but the intent of this was, as to those sections as it relates to competitive bidding and RFP, downstate won't have to do it. The reason why, it's an emergency situation. We got a critical situation there, and everyone knows about it. And if you don't provide this flexibility to implement a plan quickly, the hospital might not survive, and we don't want that to happen. So, of course, competitive bidding is a wonderful thing. So is our RFPs, and we'd use them all the time. But when you have an emergency, you got to do something outside the box. And for this case, this emergency authority is only given to the downstate situation.
Through you, Mr. President, if the sponsor would continue to yield.
Senator DeFrancisco, do you yield?
Yes.
Sponsor yields.
Through you, Mr. President, so in this instance, not only does it remove it from these particular sections of the law, but as far as oversight, as far as whether there would be an agency, whether it's actually, first of all, whether the legislature would be able to look into what's happening there through, Mr. President, or more importantly, if the controller would be willing, would be able to look into the expenditures that are made in the middle of this process, does this section or does any other section of this law actually allow for either the legislature or the controller to look more specifically into the expenditures that are made through this emergency plan?
First of all, it has to be approved by the Commissioner of Health. So there's some oversight there. That's number one. Number two, just like any other state expenditures, the Comptroller's Office obviously has some oversight of state expenditures. In addition, there was actually even a section in here that downstate shall post on its website for a period of no less than 15 days a description of proposed goods and services to be provided under various contracts, the criteria for contractor selection. So there's actually public disclosure of what they're doing in addition to the oversight of the health department as well as the controller's office. And by the way, for those in the state, I know there's some in the state who don't like the idea of this kind of flexibility. Generally, again, it's only for downstate, and it's only for a period of 1 year, thinking that that's the crucial period of time with which things have to be done. And by that time, I imagine the state will know one way or the other what else has to be done to save the hospital and go back to the regular procedures.
Through you, Mr. President, the sponsor will continue to yield.
D. Francisco?
Yes.
Sponsor yields.
Thank you, Mr. President. So on the issue specifically, Mr. President, of contracting, and that's one that I want to make sure that we establish for the record. So on issues of contracting, which may include anything and everything that could potentially happen in this institution, whether it's providing medical services, whether it's maintenance of the facilities, whether it's renovation of the facilities, in any and all contracts that might be made by this institution during this process of restructuring, I want to talk specifically about the oversight on those contracts. It seems to me, and maybe I've interpreted the language wrong, but it seems to me that the Department of Health and the Commissioner of Health have no oversight over these contracts. And if they do, I'd like, through you, Mr. President, if the sponsor could correct me, but it seems to me that they do not have that authority.
Paying attention, I'm sorry. I was trying to get another question clarified, but I will pay attention this time.
Through you, Mr. President.
Please restate your question.
I will absolutely restate my question, Mr. President. As I understand it, the language does not allow for the Department of Health or the Commissioner of Health specifically to have oversight over the contracting that is done during this period of restructuring by this entity. And contracts understood to be anything and everything that this entity could do. And I'll repeat again for the record, whether we're talking about medical services directly, whether we're talking about remodeling facilities, whether we're talking about providing food or other types of services, in any and all of these instances, it seems to me that the Department of Health and the Commissioner of Health do not have oversight over the contracts. And furthermore, if the contracts, as I heard the sponsor state earlier, that this period of this emergency plan would be only for 1 year. I do not find language in the section or any other section that would bar any type of contract that could be made during this period when there is no oversight that goes beyond that period of a year. So if the sponsor could clarify that for me, please.
As far as the oversight, remember the plan that's got to be prepared by June 1 is a plan that has to be approved by the Department of Health, the Commissioner of Health. So as a practical matter, he can put whatever parameters he wants on it that the downstate has to follow. And if he thinks he needs specific authority to reject a part of the plan or not allow them to go to a longer-term contract, that can be handled in the rejection of the plan. And then once the plan is in place, the commissioner oversees what they're doing to make sure that they are in compliance with the plan. So it's not that there's no oversight, it's just that there's more flexibility and for that emergency period.
Mr. President, the sponsor will continue to yield.
Senator DeFrancisco. Sponsor yields.
Thank you, Mr. President. As far as that, the process that was just described by the sponsor referred to whether the plan is accepted. As we discussed prior, an earlier section of the bill states that the process would be within 2 weeks, the damned if you don't, damned if you do part of the conversation, 2 weeks for the proposal to be put into effect, to be implemented. What if that during that period of time, the Department of Health rejects the plan? What would happen then?
Well, I would assume that SUNY would get back to the drawing board very quickly. And I don't think it's a matter of what's planned here, I think, is a submission. And while they're submitting it, I'm sure there has to be discussions with the Department of Health as the plan is being developed to make sure they're not going in the wrong direction. So again, the short leash is to try to get things moving. I would imagine that if they needed legislative authority, for example, after the remember, it's whilst we're still in the legislature, I imagine if it's rejected on June 15th, they could come back here and say, wait a minute, we need 2 more weeks, or we need whatever we need. But hopefully there'll be discussions as the plan is developed to make sure the planners are accommodating what the commissioner is really looking for. And I would be surprised if that process hasn't already begun, quite frankly.
Through you, Mr. President, if the sponsor would continue to yield.
Sponsor yields.
So, Mr. President, on that, so let's play a hypothetical for a second, just because I want to make sure that we understand excluding this particular entity from these bills, from these laws, excuse me, these sections of the law that I mentioned before, exactly what it means. Let's say that the process, that there is a plan put forth by June 1st, it is approved and put into effect by June 15th, and on July 30th, during the folks that have taken over have putting together this plan and they're putting it forth, then they enter into a contract which actually goes, let's say, a 5-year contract, which, as we stated before, would not be eligible for any type of oversight. And as I understand it, because we're excluding it from section from Safe Finance Law 112, they would no longer be oversight from the controller's office over that contract until, you know, until after it's ratified. And if a contract is ratified, and I would like some clarification from the sponsor, if the contract is ratified and it's a contract that goes way beyond the year that is supposed to be restructuring, what happens then?
First of all, we're in an emergency situation. And if we ask the presidents of SUNY Upstate and Stony Brook whether they would like more flexibility so they can get some things done for their colleges, they would jump for joy to have that ability. What we're doing is giving the most flexibility we can to get this done. Now, of course there's always a risk that a contract isn't going to be as good as it could have been. There's always going to be a risk that something extends longer than we want it to extend. But if the program doesn't work, downstate won't be paying any of their bills soon. So whoever's contracting with the university, with SUNY under this plan, I think would have to look carefully on whether or not this plan makes sense from both sides. So we're taking a risk, of course we are, but the alternative is making them go through months and months of bidding while downstate goes further and further in a hole. When you balance those interests, you could come up with 15 hypotheticals of risks. The risk of doing something, not doing anything or doing something on a slow pace is not worth it.
Through you, Mr. President, if the sponsor will continue to yield.
Yes.
Sponsor yields.
Thank you, Mr. President. I only have a few more questions on this issue, and then I'm moving briefly to another. If we move to Section 9, Mr. President, there is...
You messed up my sheet.
It adds a new section to the public health law that would allow SUNY Downstate, among other institutions, to participate in the Delivery System Reform Incentive Payments Program. That's DSRIP. Is this a waiver program that New York State currently, through you, Mr. President, is this a waiver program that currently New York State participates in?
Yes.
Through you, Mr. President, if the sponsor would continue to yield.
Senator DeFrancisco, do you yield?
Yes.
Sponsor.
Thank you, Mr. President. It is my understanding that this is part of a Medicaid 1115 waiver that the state of New York has not currently submitted an application for. As I understand it, only the state of California and the state of Texas are currently participating in this particular Medicaid waiver. So, Mr. President, through you, does the sponsor have any other information about whether the state of New York has actually applied for this particular waiver?
I guess the answer is that we do this with various other waivers, this particular process, and you're absolutely correct. So when I say that we do these things now, we do. On this particular waiver, you're correct. We haven't applied for it yet, but obviously this allows for what it says in the bill, in assuming that we do obtain that approval by the federal government.
Through you, Mr. President, if the sponsor would continue to yield.
Yes.
Sponsor yields.
Thank you, Mr. President. So I might understand then that we are including a section here in the law which would allow this institution to get access to funding through a waiver program that we have not applied for, and furthermore, that it is a part of a larger waiver proposal process that we have already been in for over a year, perhaps. If we're already for over a year, we've been asking for all sorts of, in this waiver process, we've been asking for all sorts of money from the federal government. Are we saying then that, I did not find language here, maybe I can get clarification from the sponsor, but I did not find language that says that the state is going to apply for this. Are we going to then amend the process that's already been ongoing for a year to make sure that we would get access to this, to money from this waiver?
We need the authority for this because what we're going to be asking for from the federal government is what is needed to in furtherance of the sustainability plan. There's already discussions with the Department of Health and the federal government that we are going to make this application, the reason we're going to make this application, but depending upon what the plan is will depend upon the exact nature of the waiver request. Now, I would assume we could also just leave this out, and once the waiver is granted, come back, pass another bill to allow for what we want to allow for here. But obviously, this just gives us the authority. If we never get the waiver approval, this section would be moot.
So we'll continue to yield.
Senator DeFrancisco,
yes.
We continue to yield. The sponsor yields.
I actually want to go back briefly to Section 6 because there's one thing that I missed and I want to make sure that I get clarification, Mr. President. Section 6, again, is the one that deals with opting out of the certain areas of the law which would allow for some level of oversight from different entities, the controller being one of them. And also, as we said, to allow for a more flexible, using utilizing the language of the sponsor, a more flexible process by which we could contract more quickly and more efficiently. What is the consideration in this process? I do not see language that refers to MWBEs, particularly whether there is any type of standard that will be set to make sure that, yes, flexibility is obviously important, but if we're talking about an institution that is in Brooklyn and is obviously surrounded by many minority and women-owned business enterprises that could perform some of the services that we're talking about, is there something in the language, through you, Mr. President, that would allow or that establishes any type of standards as it refers to MWBEs for this particular institution and this particular plan?
The section that waives some of these provisions and gives flexibility from these provisions does not have a section in the section dealing with women and minority businesses. So we're not exempting the university from any existing law or existing executive order by the chief executive of all of those laws. It just gives flexibility and waives the provisions of the specific laws that are listed here, sections of the laws that are existed here.
Through you, Mr. President, if the sponsor would continue to yield.
Yes.
The sponsor yields.
Thank you, Mr. President. So just to be clear, State Finance Law 112, which requires any contract over $50,000 for all agencies except OGS and $85,000 for agency for OGS, to be reviewed and approved by the controller before it's effective, for example, that particular section of the law. Or the State Finance Law 63, which is about evaluating offers and awarding contracts. So you're saying that even though there is no language in the legislation that we're considering today to make sure that there is that MWBEs are considered as far as the targets that we're trying to hit in different agencies across the state, that is going to be, that we should assume that even though there is no requirement for the normal process to be undertaken to make sure that the contracts that are entered into by a state agency or a state entity are good, fair contracts, that even though that all of those requirements are waived, that the requirement that refers to MWBEs through you, Mr. President, is going to continue to be observed and respected?
That's my reading of this bill.
I don't administer contracts, and I don't enforce women and business-owned, women and minority-owned business regulations. I'm just saying the bill does not waive those other provisions that currently exist.
Through you, Mr. President, if the sponsor would continue to yield.
Yes.
Sponsor yields.
Thank you, Mr. President. I skipped over a very important section. I want to make sure we go back to it, and that's section 7.
I would hope so.
You were thinking I was going to skip it, but that's the one that you're most ready. I'm sorry, right. Mr. President, through you.
Haven't read it.
I'm thinking that the sponsor might be particularly ready for questions regarding this section, so I shall, through you, ask them. This particular section refers to allowing access to for-profit corporations to operate part or some of the entity. Is that, through you, Mr. President, is that a correct interpretation?
Correct.
Through you, Mr. President, if the sponsor would continue to yield.
Yes.
Thank you, Mr. President. There is language in here that refers specifically to allowing access for a private institution to potentially run the day-to-day operations of the entity. Is that a correct interpretation through you, Mr. President?
Potentially. However, there's a provided, however, in here as well, which says that any such contracts with for-profit entities shall be authorized only upon approval by the Commissioner of Health and the Director of the Division of the Budget of a request by the Chancellor demonstrating financial need of the university or of the state university healthcare facility. So it gives that flexibility, but there's a leash on that flexibility by the leash being held by the Commissioner of Health as well as the Budget Director.
Through you, Mr. President, if the sponsor will continue to yield.
Yes.
So, Mr. President, as far as that leash is concerned, that leash does not have one part of the leash that extends to us as a legislature or another one that extends itself to the controller. Is that correct, to continue the metaphor?
Excuse me, I won't use the word leash. I won't use the word damned if you do and damned if you don't. Very clearly, it has to be subject to the approval of both the Commissioner of Health and the Budget Director. They are the administrators of the hospital as well as the overall state budget. So we don't normally administer anything. And I hope we never do administer trying to save a hospital, because I don't know that we'd ever get it done. And so there is this oversight, and there is this protection.
Through you, Mr. President, if the sponsor will continue to you.
Senator DeFrancisco.
Yes.
Sponsor yields.
All right. I want to actually move on to a different part to ask a few questions. I might come back briefly to the Part Q, but I want to ask a couple of questions about Part P that has to do with the Mental Hygiene Stabilization Fund. I think some of my colleagues are going to be going a little bit deeper into this, but I want to ask specifically about the, let's ask first, I'm sorry, through you, Mr. President, if the sponsor would please explain the overall purpose of the Mental Hygiene Stabilization Fund. Through you, Mr. President, if the sponsor would take Part P, which refers to the Mental Hygiene Stabilization Fund, would explain the purpose of the creation of the Mental Hygiene Stabilization Fund.
Because my Part B deals with OTB and assistance with the cost of Medicare premiums, et cetera, et cetera. Maybe I got the wrong bill here. Part P?
Through you, Mr. President, I believe Part P as in Peter.
I think Part O, unless my numbers are wrong, relates to the stabilization fund.
Through you, Mr. President, my apologies. I was mistaken. It is Part O. So, yes, if the sponsor, through you, Mr. President, could explain the main purpose of Part O of the Mental Hygiene Stabilization Fund.
I needed help on this one, and basically what it is that we have been charged by the federal government of $1.1 billion or a little more than that of overpayments on Medicaid. So the purpose of the stabilization fund is to start saving for the when we have to pay these bills back over time, and that is the reason for the bill.
Through you, Mr. President, if the sponsor will continue to yield.
Senator DeFrancisco, do you continue to yield?
Yes, I do.
Sponsor yields.
Thank you, Mr. President. So this refers to the conversation that we've had, a lot of conversations that we've had over the last couple of weeks related to the Office of Persons with Developmental Disabilities and the cuts to that particular agency. Is that correct?
That's correct. That issue is in a different bill. What bill is it in? Aid to Localities bill.
Through you, Mr. President, if the sponsor would continue to yield.
Yes.
Sponsor yields.
If I understand it correctly, Mr. President, yes, he is correct. The sponsor is correct. Aid to Localities refers to the particular money that has been, funds that have been allocated for that particular agency. But if I'm not mistaken, this particular fund in this bill deals with transfers that are to happen between the Department of Health and OPWDD for the purposes of covering some of the gap that's going to exist because of the overpayments that the sponsor referred to earlier. So I want clarification on that to see if I am correct.
You're correct.
Through you, Mr. President, if the sponsor would continue to yield.
Yes.
Sponsor yields.
Thank you, Mr. President. There's two different periods that are covered, Mr. President, in this bill, as it refers to, and some of the analysis that we've made as far as the numbers that are going to go through the stabilization fund. This is funding that is going to be allocated from the Department of Health over to OPWDD to cover some of the shortages that are obviously going to exist at that agency because of the cuts that we are going to be discussing much more of a little bit later, certainly during aid to localities. I want to discuss specifically the out years, not only 2014, but more specifically 2014 and 2015, because it seems, and I want clarification on this from the sponsor, Mr. President, it seems that we've identified $445 million in the out years to be appropriated for the Mental Hygiene Stabilization Fund. However, it seems that what we're doing is we're counting on money that perhaps would be coming from the federal government. So it seems that the analysis that we've made of the numbers tells us that what's happening, Mr. President, is that we're assuming or we're wishing that in 2014 and 2015, this $445 million is given to us from the federal government, and therefore we would be able to plug the hole that would exist in this particular fund that we're creating with this bill. Is that correct, Mr. President, through you?
Trying to maximize reimbursement from the federal government for Medicaid. So, of course, we're wishing that more funds come in, but the purpose of the stabilization fund is to make sure that we will have the funds available from our own budget in the event that those additional funds don't come up in from the federal government.